you know the song, even some of the younger ones. And last week, on the CBC, they said, Percy Sledge died. That's Percy Sledge. And it made me choke, I cry, just like I'm choking up now. And sure, I slow dance to that long ago, and probably you haven't, even now it comes up. But why would I cry? And then I realized, it was a hit in 1966, and in 1966, as a student from Berkeley, I went to be a camp counselor in upstate New York in this place called Sharper Room, run by the New York City Mission Society. And it was for kids from Harlem and the Lower East Side, which meant poor black, poor Puerto Rican. And they came from a place in New York City called Cavalcade Hall, and it was an institution kind of thing where when your family didn't exist anymore, when everything had broken apart, you were as a child dumped there. Not what we think of as a group home or anything. They were just there when there was nothing left. And I was with a group of girls 13 and 14. I didn't know much about Cavalcade Hall except they had toothbrushes that were black. And they had etched on those toothbrushes, it was marked in the toothbrushes, property of the city of New York. I mean, what did they do? You know, when the kid aged out or ran away, did they start, you know, recycling for the next kid? And somehow that struck me as the most impersonal thing. And they didn't like being at Camp Sharper Room. They knew that they were there because the place had to, Cavalcade Hall had to close down 3 weeks of the year. And they didn't like the woods, and they didn't like the dark, and they were scared of it, and they were angry. And basically the only thing they liked was the days when it rained, because they would be in the sort of, volleyball, and they didn't have to swim in that lake, because you know the lake had things in it that, you know, crawl and stuff. And so they could just drop the little 45s down on the record player and they could dance. And I was a terrible counselor. I was just awful. They couldn't stand me because I would do things like try to reason with them. Really, if we don't do this now, then this will happen. They just thought I was a fool. Even one time when I'm said to me, Marylee, you gotta yell at us. That's what we do. I tried to yell once and I looked even dumber. It didn't really work. But I had two things going for me, I have to say. One was I had streaky blondish hair. And they were very preoccupied with the hair. Any 13 or 14 year old girl would, but because they were black and blue, you know, they didn't have any of the, it wasn't you had afro, you wanted to be able to like straighten your hair, you needed products, you needed like a mama to help you or a big sister, they didn't have any of that. And so even though they'd be angry at me, they'd in the middle of it stop and touch my head and say, oh, you've got the good hair. The other thing is, I could dance, whether you believe it or not, I could do that, eh? The holy gully, you name it, I could do that. Session in the 3 weeks, there would be a talent show. And there was one girl that I noticed, because she was not exactly a loner, but you know, they'd put three or four of them and kind of work on their hair or talk or yell or dance. She wasn't ever a part of things. She was very thin, and though she was clean and everything, you could tell her hair was getting nappy. There was just, she was just really separate. And her legs, I've never bent backwards. You know, not full legged, but kind of bowed back. joy every time Percy Sledge and the other sort of Atlantic record Motown people come in the flashy clothes and they'd go see Percy Sledge. And when I called, I said, "Hey, Richard, you know, the guy today goes, Percy Sledge." So I told him this story. And he said, "You know, maybe you should love him. Wherever she is, that girl, she'll hear that song, she'll hear he died. But it'll remind her of that wonderful time, that wonderful moment that she said, love you." And I thought, given where she came from, she'll be lucky if she's still alive.